Ah, there's Ayushi. Hi there. Can't hear you. And there's Dr. Professor Coomer. Okay.
Good evening, Dr. Gladys.
Yes, good morning to you. All right. A lot of people are here. Yeah.
Hello, how are you?
I'm doing good, thank you. Whoop, and here is a special guest. Here's the cat.
Wow, that's great.
Yeah, yeah. He's interested also to learn some chemistry.
Okay. So how are you feeling now? Have you recovered?
I'm feeling good. Yeah, it's early enough for me. So don't worry at all. I'm certainly good for the next hour. No problem.
Okay. So good morning, everyone. Today, on the occasion of pre-PhD seminar of Ms. Ayushi Arora, I welcome all the members of Doctoral Research Committee, Dr. Charu Dwivedi, Dr. Vikas Rana, Dr. Ujjwal Kumar, all the research scholars and all the students. I also welcome Professor Kusum Arunachalam, who has been our dean for a very long time. Now I extend a very warm welcome to our distinguished guest, Professor John A. Gladys, who has also been a mentor of Ayushi Arora, and at present he is distinguished professor and Dow chair in chemical convention at Department of Chemistry, Texas A&M University, USA. Ayushi Arora joined Department of Chemistry in year 2017. In year 2019, Indo-US Science and Technology Forum awarded her Indo-US Fellowship for Women in STEM. With this fellowship, she visited Texas A&M University in year 2020, where she worked under the supervision of Professor John A. Gladys. As DRC has recommended to conduct her pre-PhD seminar and submit the thesis, today she will present her research work. Now I invite Ayushi, and I expect that she will be delivering her presentation and highlighting all the salient aspects and features of her research work. Ayushi, come and deliver your talk.
Thank you, sir. Good morning, everyone. I am a PhD candidate in Department of Chemistry under the supervision of Dr. Arun Kumar. The title of my PhD thesis is the development of novel organochalcogen compounds for transition metal catalytic systems, their development and applications. The approved objectives of the study include the designing of multidentate organochalcogen ligands, incorporating imine or amine as a functionality to synthesize the palladium two complexes of these organochalcogen ligands, to explore the effect of these ligands as a stabilizer, also to observe the efficiency of design molecular catalysts in various synthetic transformations, to design metal chalcogenide nanoparticles using single source precursor method, and to immobilize such nanoparticles on some solid support, and also to evaluate the efficiency of such developed heterogeneous catalytic systems in various organic transformations. Mm-hmm. So the layout of my thesis includes introduction, the material methods used in the study, then chapter 3 to 6, which include the research conducted, that is the homogeneous catalyst for overylation of phenol, the nanocatalyst that consists of bimetallic PD9TE4 and PDTE alloys for Suzuki coupling reaction and the reduction of 4-nitrophenol, the development of a magnetically retrievable heterogeneous catalytic system, which was designed by the immobilization of organoselenium ligand stabilized copper nanoparticles on chitosan layered magnetite, and a homogeneous pre-catalyst system for Suzuki coupling reaction, and conclusion. So we begin with introduction. As we all know that catalysts can be divided into three different categories known as homogeneous catalysts, nanocatalysts, and heterogeneous catalysts. So the homogeneous catalysts and heterogeneous catalysts have some major differences. In the homogeneous catalyst, the catalyst and the reactant lie in the same phase. All sites are available for the reaction, but it is difficult to recover the catalyst and hence it's lost in during the reaction. But possible reaction mechanism can be easily proposed. However, in heterogeneous catalytic systems, the catalyst and the reactant, they lie in different phase. All sites are not available for the reaction, but the retrieval of the catalyst from the reaction mixture can be achieved via different means like magnetic separation, centrifugation, or filtration. But there is a difficulty in gaining mechanistic insights. Ligands play a very important role in tuning the electronic and the steric properties of the metal center in catalyst. Bulky ligands play a very important role in all the three different catalytic systems. That is, in homogeneous catalytic systems, they stabilize the catalyst in coordinatively unsaturated intermediate stage. They also accelerate the reductive elimination step in coupling reactions. In nanocatalytic systems, they act as efficient stabilizers. They encapsulate the nanoparticles, but at the same time, stabilizer must not encapsulate the nanoparticle completely, and with it should be it should keep a balance between stabilizing and their catalytic activity. In heterogeneous catalytic systems, which are designed by immobilizing the molecular complex on some solid support, the ligand play a similar role as it plays in homogeneous catalytic systems. When the preformed nanoparticles are immobilized onto some solid support, ligands play the role of a stabilizer, as in the case of nanocatalytic systems. So the important discovery of CC coupling reactions date back to 1979, when Suzuki and Miura first discovered the Suzuki coupling reaction of aryl halide with alkenyl boranes. And the first catalyst that was explored in this category was tetrakis triphenyl phosphine palladium zero. And the reaction was carried out at 120 degrees centigrade for 2 hours. Now, Suzuki coupling reaction is a very important reaction. It holds importance because the products which are obtained from Suzuki coupling reaction finds application in natural products, in polymers, agrochemicals, drugs, pharmaceuticals, and biologically active compounds. These are some of the examples that of the compounds that have been synthesized using Suzuki coupling reaction. Now, important catalysts that have been reported so far mainly consist of phosphine and carbenes derived catalytic systems. In 1990s, there were mainly phosphine ligated palladium complexes that were used as a catalyst for Suzuki coupling reaction. That is, in 1999, first imine based phosphine catalytic system was used for coupling aryl bromides with vinyl boronic acid with an average reaction time of 16 hours, which is quite a long time. Now, in 2005, a variety of phosphorus-containing catalytic systems have been designed, and the reaction was carried out in dioxane and water in the presence of a strong base, that is K3PO4. Then later on in 2012, Liu et al. Actually designed a heterogeneous catalytic system by immobilizing palladium acetate on phosphine-coated magnetite. The catalyst loading of 0.5% has been explored for Suzuki coupling reaction for aryl bromides and a reaction time of 12 hours. Also, a heterogeneous palladium catalyst knitted in a NHC porous polymer has also been used as a low catalyst loading of 0.057 mole percent, but it was mainly used for aryl bromides and the reaction time ranged from 8 to 24 hours. However, phosphine ligated catalytic systems have several limitations, including their air and moisture insensitivity. Therefore, the reaction can never be scaled up to an industrial level. Therefore, the researchers tend to find more robust catalytic systems. In this regard, they shifted their focus to chalcogen organochalcogen based ligands, which contain sulfur, selenium, or tellurium as a donor in the catalytic framework. So organochalcogen compounds is an emerging field in catalyst because they are air and moisture insensitive, they are robust, they are resistant to oxidation, and they can tolerate a variety of functional groups during catalytic transformation. A major study was conducted in 2004 when Yao et al. Designed a selenium ligated PD2 pincer complex, and it was used as a very efficient catalyst for Heck coupling reaction. Thereafter, several organosulfur and organoselenium compounds have been utilized for the development of various catalytic systems. In which regard, in 2012, Rao et al. Actually used a chalcogeno ether ligand for the stabilization of PD0 nanoparticles. And it was used as a nanocatalyst for Suzuki coupling reaction, but it required higher mole percent for cheaply available chloroarenes. The distinct feature of the reaction was the coupling of bromide, aryl bromides with phenylboronic acid in a very short reaction time of 3 hours. A homogeneous catalytic systems containing sulfur or selenium and a triazole core have also been used as a catalyst, and they have been explored for Suzuki and Heck coupling reactions at a catalyst loading of 0.1 to 0.01 mole percent. Now, having said that, organosulfur and organoselenium compounds have been explored in great depth in the Suzuki coupling reactions, but organotellurium compounds have always been at the back seat in this. There are only a few organotellurium compounds that have been used for catalyst development for Suzuki coupling reactions, and some of their advantages, such as their low electronegativity, their high metallic character, their high nucleophilic character, have been overlooked upon. Similar is the case with metal tellurides. Now, tellurium, as we all know, is a metalloid and makes alloys with another metal. The applications of transition metal tellurides, apart from palladium, have been well known. But even though there are several known phases of palladium, no report exists on the development of palladium telluride at nanoscale, except for palladium telluride phase, that is PDTE. Now, in addition to CC coupling reaction, CX coupling reaction, also known as Ullmann coupling reaction, have also established its importance in the scientific arena. It was first developed by Fritz Ullmann in 1901, who actually carried out CO coupling reaction for the synthesis of diaryl ether in the presence of finely divided copper. They also have got immense utility in pharmaceutical, polymers, agrochemicals, and natural products. Diaryl ether moiety is an important motif or an important scaffold in many different transformations. Now, mainly the reaction was copper catalyzed. So in the initial catalyst consists of copper-based catalytic systems. In this regard, in 1992, copper salts were used as a catalyst for the conversion of aryl iodides to phenol, to couple with phenol to result in diaryl ethers at 140 degrees centigrade for 24 hours. During the period of 1992 to 2007, various other salts of copper have been used as a catalyst. However, in 2008, Zhang et al. Designed a nanocatalyst, that is copper oxide NPs, to substitute to couple various substituted phenol with iodobenzene. However, even for the coupling with iodobenzene, 18 to 24 hours of reaction time led only to moderate yields, not greater than 80%. Also, copper NPs decorated on graphite nanoribbons have also been explored for CO coupling reactions. But though the reaction time has been subsequently reduced to 4 to 8 hours, but the reaction was still carried out at 180 degrees centigrade with a very high amount of catalyst, that is 10 mole percent. A recent study also have been carried out by designing in heterogeneous catalytic systems, which was able to catalyze the reaction at a moderate temperature with 20 milligram of catalyst loading. But the main substrate scope was only confined till aryl iodides and aryl bromides. Aryl chlorides, which are cheaply available and least reactive aryl chloride, aryl halides, have not been explored by copper catalyst. Now, we can say that long reaction time has been a drawback in the coupling reactions. In majority of the coupling reactions, there are several other drawbacks that have been associated with the copper-based catalytic systems. They include the insolubility of copper catalyst in many organic solvents. The reaction occurred at very high temperatures ranging from 130 degrees to 200 degrees for aryl chlorides, which are the most reactive aryl halides. The longer durations of the reaction and the instability of substituted phenol at these higher temperature. Now, therefore, the researchers tend to explore the other transition metal catalyst, and the only other category that has been explored in this regard is palladium-containing catalytic systems. With Gaurishankar and co-workers in 2012 actually explored palladium acetate as a catalyst. So the reaction proceeded well in 10 hours at 80 degrees centigrade for aryl bromides. Also, in terms of searching robust catalytic systems, only very few organochalcogen-based catalytic systems have been explored in this regard. One such study was conducted in 2013 when PD17 SE15 nanoparticles immobilized on graphene oxide have been explored as a catalyst for various aryl bromides and aryl chlorides. The major advantage of this reaction was that the reaction occurred in a green solvent, that is water, but it required extra, actually high loading of catalyst concentration, that is 1 mole%. Also, homogeneous catalysts have also been designed in this regard, which consist of ferrocene core and a sulfur or a selenium donor atom in the catalyst framework. And it was used for both aryl bromides as well as cheaply available aryl chlorides. Though cheaply available aryl chlorides led to very moderate conversions, the reaction proceeded at 120 degrees centigrade and at 0.5 mole percent of catalyst loading. But it can be said that organosulfur and organoselenium ligands have not been explored extensively in this regard, and especially the homogeneous catalysts. Therefore, the materials and methods that I used was the synthesis with organochalcogen compounds that contain imine functionality via one-step condensation reaction of amine and a carbonyl compound. The PD2 compounds were synthesized using bisacetonitrile dichloropalladium 2 as a palladium precursor. The nanocatalysts have been developed using two different approaches. One is the borohydride reduction method, and second is the using organotellurium compounds as single source precursors. The characterization of various catalytic systems have been carried out using different techniques, that is for nanocatalytic and heterogeneous catalytic systems. The characterization was performed using PXRD, SEMI-DX or HRTEM techniques. The molecular complexes have been characterized using proton NMR and single crystal X-ray diffraction techniques. The catalytic systems were explored in different chemical transformations, including Suzuki coupling, over-ionization of phenol and reduction of nitrorenes. So the first study actually included the development of homogeneous catalytic systems for over-ionization of phenol. That is, so we all know that phenoxide ion is less reactive in comparison to its alkoxide ion because phenoxide ion is stabilized by resonance. As a result, it is difficult to couple with aryl iodides or any other aryl halides. So diaryl ether is an important scaffold in many different products. Therefore, need of better catalyst still persists, and organosulfur and organoselenium based homogeneous catalytic systems have not been explored extensively in this regard. To keep that in mind, the organosulfur and organoselenium ligand containing pyrene moiety and a sulfur or a selenium donor atom has been synthesized via the reaction of one pyrene carboxaldehyde with a corresponding amine in good yields, that is 95% and 96%. The compounds were then utilized for the development of palladium 2 complexes using bisacetonitrile dichloropalladium 2 as a palladium source in chloroform hexane medium. The desired complexes were also afforded in a short reaction time and in high yields of 93 to 94%. The ligands and the complexes have been characterized by various spectroscopic techniques and X-ray diffraction techniques. This is the proton NMR of both the ligands showing the characteristic imine peak. The carbon 13 NMR for ligands, organosulfur and organoselenium ligands. The single crystal X-ray diffraction technique was used to confirm the structure of both the complexes, which showed that palladium binds in bidentate mode, yielding a square planar geometry. They were then explored for their efficiency in the CO coupling reaction of aryl bromides and aryl chlorides with phenol using both the catalysts. So it was found that 3 to 10 hours of reaction time was sufficient enough at 0.1 mole percent of catalyst loading to convert aryl bromides into their subsequent diaryl ether derivatives in high yields. That is, it is 99% in majority of the cases. A preliminary study was also conducted on aryl chlorides, and it was found that 12 hours of reaction time was enough to convert 4-chlorobenzaldehyde into its diaryl ether derivative and in 79% conversion and 82% conversion with sulfur and selenium ligated PD2 complexes respectively. Also, So the white substrate scope can be seen here, and we have observed relatively good percentage conversions. Also, the nature of the catalysis was determined using poisoning test, in which elemental mercury was used as a poisoning agent and 4-bromo-nitrobenzene was used as a model reaction. It was found that there was no significant difference in the percentage conversion obtained with or without poisoning agent. Similar results were also obtained with triphenylphosphine with triphenylphosphine was used as a poisoning agent. And it, since there was no significant effect on the conversion, it can be said that catalysis proceeds via a homogeneous pathway. That is, PD0 nanoparticles, if developed, are well protected by the ligand, which allows the reactant to reach the surface, but they do not allow bigger molecules like mercury or PPH3 to poison the catalyst. So the present study concludes the easy synthesis and a hassle-free synthesis of sulfur-selenium ligated PD2 complexes, which are air and moisture insensitive, thermally stable, and possess a long shelf life. They have been found efficient to convert aryl halides into their diaryl ether derivatives at 0.1 mol% of catalyst loading. Exhibit a wide substrate scope, including aryl bromides and cheaply available aryl chlorides. So the next study includes the development of bimetallic PD94 and PDT alloys as nanocatalysts for Suzuki coupling reaction of chloroarenes and the reduction of 4-nitrophenol. We all know that single source precursor route involves the incorporation of all the elements into a single molecular complex that act as a single source precursor and which, when thermalized, yields nanostructures of different composition. The advantages of single source precursor route include that it does not require distinct sources for palladium or chalcogen. It does not require sophisticated equipments. It does not require the high temperatures. However, it leads to easy reaction handling. The additional advantages include the minimum possibility of contamination because only one single source precursor is incorporated, and the hassle-free workup procedures because the organic content can be easily removed by centrifugation or filtration. So keeping that in mind, organotellurium ligands have never been explored as single source precursors for the development of palladium tellurides, and the effect of their architecture on the composition of the alloys have rarely been investigated. So we designed L3 and L4 as two organotellurium compounds containing amine and imine as a functionality, which were then used for the synthesis of their palladium 2 complexes, 3 and 4, with bidentate mode of coordination and tridentate mode of coordination. The ligands were characterized by proton NMR spectroscopy, 13 carbon spectroscopy, and the complexes were also characterized using PDT 125 TE NMR spectroscopy that represents a highly deshielded signal in then, and the coordination mode of the PD2 complexes was established using single crystal X-ray diffraction technique, which showed that in complex 3 there is a bidentate mode of coordination, in complex 4 there is a tridentate mode of coordination. Now these molecular complexes then act as single source precursors, and when thermolyzed at 260 degrees centigrade and 240 degrees centigrade, led to the formation of PD9TE4 and PDTE bimetallic alloys, which were characterized using different characterization techniques. The crystal structure of PD9TE4 has been known and reported since the year 1978. However, no work has been done on its fabrication at nanoscale. Similar status is with PDTE. The crystal structure has been known since 1990. However, there is only one study that has been conducted on its fabrication at nanoscale, but no exploration on its catalytic potential has been carried out. So this is the X-ray diffraction patterns of PD9TE4 and PDTE that confirms the compositions as such. And the X-ray, the energy dispersive X-ray spectra of PD9TE4 that confirms its elemental composition. The HRTEM images of PD9TE4 and PDTE nanoparticles reveal that they have an average particle size of 10 to 25 nanometers, and the morphology of the particles appear to be spherical in shape. The particle size distribution was also calculated using DLS, that is dynamic light scattering techniques, and it was found that polydispersity index is 0.336, which indicate that there is no agglomeration of the nanoparticles. The adsorption isotherm was also recorded using BET technique, which suggests that both the nanocatalysts are non-porous materials as they have a very small pore size of nearly 2 nanometer. The aryl halides, which were used in the coupling reaction when these nanocatalysts were explored, mainly included aryl chlorides because they have minimum cost and they are least reactive because of the high bond strength of CCl bond. So they have to be successfully utilized in coupling reaction, and hence the need for better catalyst persisted. So the mainly aryl chlorides were explored for this coupling reaction, including 4-chlorobenzaldehyde, 4-chloronitrobenzene, 4-chloroacetophenone, 4-chlorobenzonitrile, and chlorobenzene. So it can be seen that 4-chlorobenzaldehyde, when coupled with phenylboronic acid, gave the maximum percentage conversion, that is 88% with PD9TE4 and 87% with PDTE nanocatalyst. And an average percentage conversion was above moderate, that is, all the chloroarenes were converted into their respective biaryl derivatives in greater than 78% conversions. Hence, it can be said that the present nanocatalysts can work as efficient catalytic systems for Suzuki coupling reaction of least reactive chloroarenes. Also, the catalysts were explored for the reduction of 4-nitrophenol, and it was found that the complete degradation of 4-nitrophenol can be achieved in 5.5 minutes in aqueous medium. And a high rate constant of 0.265 per minute has been achieved with the present nanocatalytic systems from both the nanocatalytic systems. The recyclability of PD9TE4 nanoparticles have been studied, and they were found to be recyclable up to 6 reaction cycles with only a 20% decrease in the conversion of the substrate into its biaryl derivative from first to the 6th reaction cycle. Hence, the present study concludes that it is the first architectural controlled easy synthesis of PD9TE4 and PDTE bimetallic alloys, which were the first study for the fabrication of such alloys on the nanoscale. They were highly efficient for Suzuki coupling reaction of cheaply available and least reactive chloroarenes, as well as for the reduction of 4-nitrophenol. They actually had a wide substrate scope for chloroarenes, and a high rate constant has been observed for the reduction of 4-nitrophenol when compared to other palladium based catalytic systems which do not contain any organotellurium or organocharcogen moiety, and they were found to be insensitive towards air and moisture and were recyclable up to 6 reaction cycles. The third study includes the development of a magnetically retrievable heterogeneous catalytic system that has been designed using organoselenium ligand stabilized copper nanoparticles, which were immobilized on chitosan layered magnetite, and they were used for the reduction of 4-nitrophenol. As we all know that organoselenium compounds have the potential to stabilize transition metal nanoparticles, the combination of sulfur donor with easily modifiable organic groups can lead to desired electronic and steric properties, which can be harnessed as building blocks in catalyst development. But very limited work has been done in this regard, because mainly organoselenium ligands, which shown below, has been used for the stabilization of metals of only palladium metal. They have not been used for the stabilization of any other metal. Hence, the synthetic strategy included the development of L5 stabilized copper NPs. L5 is which is an organoselenium ligand containing selenium donor and an amine functionality, but was used as a stabilizer for the development of these L5 stabilized copper NPs, which were then actually reacted with chitosan layered magnetite in ethanol for 24 hours to lead to the development of this heterogeneous catalytic systems, which was found to be magnetically separable. The ligand was actually synthesized by the reduction of its corresponding amine derivative, and the structure of the ligand was elucidated using single crystal X-ray diffraction technique. The heterogeneous catalyst was characterized using FTIR techniques that confirms the formation of the present heterogeneous catalytic systems. Also, the PXRD spectra of each component of the heterogeneous catalytic systems have been carried out, and it can be seen that the successful immobilization of copper NPs on the chitosan layered magnetite can be seen via two peaks, which is at 43.4 degrees and 49.2 degrees, along with the peaks available for Fe3O4 and chitosan. Hence, it can be said that the present heterogeneous catalyst has been successfully formed. Also, in addition to that, the present spectra has also been the microscopic studies, that is SEM-EDS and HRTEM technique, have also been microscopic studies have also been used for the characterization. SEM-EDS confirmed that all the elements are present in the heterogeneous catalyst. So it which further was corroborated from the Raman spectroscopic studies, which showed a characteristic peak at 265 centimeter inverse for which are characteristic for CuSe interactions in the heterogeneous catalyst, and also the modes resulting from magnetite and for the from the organic moiety, that is from the CC vibrations. So then thereafter they were explored for the reduction of nitroarenes, and 4-nitrophenol was used as a model study. So we did some control experiments to find out the true catalytic species, and it was found that magnetite, chitosan or chitosan layered magnetite showed no conversion of 4-nitrophenol into 4-aminophenol. However, the conversion was showed only by the catalyst that contained copper. So it can be seen that with maximum conversion, that is greater than 99%, was achieved with the present heterogeneous catalytic systems. The slightly higher conversion has been has also been achieved with L5 stabilized copper NPs, but that is because of the high copper content. So the kinetic studies were performed using 4-nitrophenol as a substrate. And when NaBH4 was added, there was a red shift because of the formation of phenolate ion. And the, it was found that complete degradation of 4-nitrophenol to 4-aminophenol was achieved in 10 minutes with a high rate constant of 0.35 per minute. The catalyst was then used for a wide substrate scope at room temperature in aqueous medium, and it was found that a variety of nitro derivatives were used as substrates, and which were all converted to their amino derivatives in greater than 90% conversion at room temperature and in aqueous medium with only 3 milligram of the catalyst, and in only 3 milligram of catalyst and in 2 hours of reaction time, we achieved greater than 90% conversion in all the cases. So the effect of temperature was also studied to find the activation energy, and the activation energy in the present case was found to be 31.7 kilojoules per mole, which is one of the lowest reported for any heterogeneous catalytic system. The present catalyst was found to be magnetically retrievable, and it was recyclable up to 5 different reaction cycles. We also performed the kinetic study of each reaction cycle, and the yield of the product was greater than 99% with each cycle. However, the time required for each consecutive reaction increased due to the possibility that there may be some active sites which may have been rendered passive. So the present study concludes the first report on the use of organoselenium ligands as a stabilizers for a non-noble metal, that is copper. And then it was also the first study when organoselenium ligand stabilized copper NPs have been preformed, and then they have been immobilized on chitosan layered magnetite. They were air and moisture insensitive. They were thermally stable. They possess a long shelf life, and the catalyst was efficient and active at a very low catalyst loading of 0.27 mole percent at room temperature, and it allowed the reaction to occur in a green solvent, water, having a wide substrate scope and easy recyclability due to magnetic separation. The last study is the tellurium ligated PD2 complex that act as a homogeneous pre-catalyst for Suzuki coupling reaction. As we all know, catalyst loading is an important parameter in the reaction which governs the economy of the whole process. And it was also expected that the presence of metal tellurium bond will be expected to show greater catalytic efficiency. So in view of that, an organotellurium compound with an amine functionality has been synthesized via one-step addition elimination reaction of pyrene carboxyldehyde with 2-phenyltelluroethylamine. And the organotellurium ligand was then used as a ligand precursor for the synthesis of its palladium 2 complex in high yield, that is 90%, using bisacetonitrile dichloropalladium as a palladium source and in chloroform hexane medium. So the characterization was performed for the organotellurium ligand was performed using proton NMR, carbon-13 NMR, also from 125 TE NMR, The 125 TENMR of the palladium 2 complex has also been recorded. That shows a deshielded peak at 621.90. The crystal structure of the palladium 2 complex was also elucidated using single crystal X-ray refraction technique. Before carrying out the coupling reaction, the optimization of base and solvent was also carried out, and it was found that K2CO3 served as the most suitable base and aqueous DMF as the most suitable solvent system for the present reaction. In addition to carrying out the optimization for base, the optimization of catalyst loading has also been carried out, and it was found that greater than 99% conversion has been achieved in only a short reaction time of 3 hours at 10⁻³ mole percent of the catalyst. When a tenfold decrease in the concentration of the catalyst was achieved, 9 hours of reaction time was enough to yield greater than 99% conversion. Therefore, a further tenfold decrease was afforded, and it was found that 18 hours of reaction time is necessary to get high conversions at this low catalyst loading. Since 18 hours is a significant reaction time, we thought of performing the catalysis at this very low mole per catalyst concentration, that is 10⁻⁵ mole percent, and a variety of aryl bromides that were explored actually gave greater than 99% conversions at this low catalyst loading. Even 4-bromophenol and 4-bromoanisole were also coupled with phenylboronic acid, and they gave 31% and 11% conversion to their biaryl derivatives at this 10⁻⁵ mole percent of catalyst loading in 18 hours of reaction time. So this resulted in very high turnover numbers and turnover frequencies that have been afforded in the present case, which is the turnover number has been of 9.9 × 10⁶ has been achieved for 4 different substrates, and yielding a very high turnover frequency of 5.5 × 10⁵. Even for 4-bromoanisole, that shows the minimum percentage conversion, a turnover frequency of 10⁴ has been afforded. So which is relatively high than many other catalytic systems. So in order to shorten the reaction time, we performed the reactions, coupling reactions at higher concentration of catalyst, that is at 0.1 mole percent. So it was found that aryl bromides were successfully converted to their biaryl derivatives in only 30 minutes to 1 hour of reaction time at high catalyst loading. Also, aryl chlorides, which are cost effective and they are least reactive, so they were also explored at this catalyst loading, and it was found that they also resulted in moderate to high conversions with greater than 80% conversion in 5 cases at 0.1 mole percent of catalyst loading and in 3 hours of reaction time. So the nature of the catalysis was determined once again using the poisoning tests, and it was found that in the present case, there was with the addition of the poisoning agent, the percentage conversion reduced subsequently to 25% from 99% when there was no poisoning agent. Similar observation was achieved with triphenylphosphine. And since there was a significant drop in the percentage conversions obtained, it can be said that catalysis proceeds majorly via heterogeneous mode, and there was an observance of black particles during the course of the reaction, which were actually which were isolated, washed with water and acetone, centrifuged, dried, and then later on characterized using different techniques known as PXRD, SEM-EDX, and HRTEM technique. So the PXRD pattern confirmed the phase to be PD94, and HRTEM studies revealed that they are highly monodispersed nanoparticles with a particle size of 2 to 5 nanometers. The independent catalytic activity of isolated nanoparticles have also been carried out using 2 different substrates, that is 1-bromo-4-nitrobenzene and 1-chloro-4-nitrobenzene, using only 5 milligram of the nanoparticles. So it was found that the independent catalytic activity independent nanoparticles are also catalytically active as a result in 90% conversion of 1-bromo-4-nitrobenzene to its respective biaryl derivative. And the present study here concludes that the tellurium ligated PD2 complex containing pyrene moiety was prepared, which showed a very high efficiency at a low catalyst loading of 10^-5 mole percent. It exhibited a very high turnover number of the order of 10^-7, and it was able to catalyze cheaply available chloroarenes in a very short reaction time of 3 hours at 0.1 mole percent of catalyst loading. This is the first report where catalytically active PD94 nanoparticles have been generated in situ and have been generated in situ as a byproduct during the course of the reaction. The present catalytic system was also found to be insensitive towards air and moisture, and it possesses a long shelf life of months. So the conclusion of the present study is the use of organochalcogen compounds, which has in the development of various homogeneous, heterogeneous, and nanocatalytic systems. The homogeneous catalytic systems actually consist of all the three, that is sulfur, selenium, and tellurium ligated preformed molecular complexes of palladium. The nanocatalytic systems, that is bimetallic alloys, PD94 and PDT, have been developed. This is the first architectural controlled study in which organotellurium ligands or tellurium compounds have been used as a single source precursors for the development of such bimetallic alloys. Magnetically retrievable heterogeneous catalytic systems has also been developed, in which copper organoselenium stabilized copper nanoparticles have been immobilized on cytosine layered magnetite. And the catalytic system has been used in three different organic transformations, that is Suzuki coupling reaction, CO coupling reaction, and in the reduction of 4-nitrophenol. So I would like to acknowledge my advisor, Dr. Arun Kumar, who has been motivating me and guiding me throughout the whole journey, Professor Gladys, whose inputs have been valuable, all the group members, and Science and Engineering Research Board for financial assistance. These are the list of publications. And one of our recent article, which was published in Dalton Transaction, has been listed as a hot article because Dalton is celebrating its 50th volume. So the reviewers have listed this as an hot article. So that's all from my side. Thank you.
Thank you, Ayushi, for a good presentation. Now the session is open for questions and answers, and I can see that Professor John is very much curious to know a lot or to ask you a lot about your presentation and work.
If you're ready for questions, these are not examination questions. These are just questions from the science, like if you were giving a group meeting. And so first, I just wanted to say you've done a lot in the last year. You've, I think, been away from Texas for 12 months, maybe 13 months, and there's a lot of new chemistry here. One thing that was just a little quick for me, your coupling conditions for the phenols and the aryl halides, they're really good. I was impressed with your loading. What temperature did those catalytic reactions go at? I just kind of missed that one. So,
sir, for O-arylation of phenol, I used a temperature of 110 degrees centigrade.
80 degrees centigrade? Okay.
No, 110, all right. 110.
100 degrees. Okay, fine. Very good. And another thing, I saw two conditions for your nitroarene reduction. So when you first introduced it, I think it was slide 51, okay, I didn't see a reducing agent. But when we got to slide 66 and you used a different catalyst, there was sodium borohydride. So are you using always a reducing agent for the nitro group, like sodium borohydride, or is it sometimes not necessary? I was just a little unclear on that point.
No, for both the cases, we have used sodium borohydride as a
both cases. Agent. Okay, all right. So sorry, I missed that.
Perfectly okay.
Yeah. Okay, and then something on your crystal structures. You could put up any one of the tellurium compounds. Okay. But, you know, as you know, we've done hundreds of crystal structures, but I've never done a tellurium crystal structure. Yeah, so we can take this one. And if I look at the coordinated tellurium, it looks to me like the bond angles about the tellurium are around 90 degrees. Okay, so it's definitely not very pyramidal. Well, maybe you say it is pyramidal, but it's not, you know, like 120 degrees. It's not like, and so can you comment on the tellurium coordination geometry there? Am I reading it right that the bond angles are around 90 degrees?
Yeah. They have square planar geometry. So the bond angles are nearly around 90 degrees, not perfectly 90 in all cases, but they're nearly around 90 degrees.
Okay, fine. And I'm sure you know I'm sure you know why in your group. Okay, so now, another thing, this is a naive question. I've only got one or two more, but you know, I've never made and characterized a phase in my entire career, but I watch phases. They're very interesting. And so you could make the palladium 9, tellurium 4, okay? I think first time. Yeah. And if I understood right, palladium, tellurium, 1-to-1, that phase had been known earlier, I think maybe from your group. And so do I understand right, there are two phases then that are characterized and known right now?
Yes, palladium telluride, that was 1:1 PDT phase. It has been reported earlier, not from our group, but from a different group. But P94, it has never been fabricated. So we have fabricated it for the first time.
Yeah, that's very nice. So now, so my question is, it's very naive. Now that there's two phases, can you like mix them 1-to-1, anneal and get an intermediate phase? Or does it, you know, just sit there and do nothing? So suppose I wanted to try to make more new phases. Could I use your new phase as a building block? Just a question. I don't know the answer.
I think that is an interesting study to perform. And we can see what happens when there is a like 1:1 mixing of both the phases. If there is an intermediate, in a new intermediate phase that could be designed or developed using such mixing.
Yeah, kind of a con-proportionation, you know. So, all right. So last question, because I know, you know, you're expert, you know these kind of things. So you showed us a lot of crystal, a lot of catalysts with pyrene. I think this is your research group signature. I remember that from your group meetings that you gave here as well. But I forget why you like pyrene. So in other words, is it something that keeps a catalyst homogeneous? Is it something that stabilizes a nanoparticle? Is it something that gives crystallinity? So tell me the one or two most important things about the pyrene components of your system.
First of all, using pyrene was because it's a 4-benzene ring fused together. So it would help. It is a rigid molecule and it would help us in getting crystals easily. Then second is it's a bulky group. So we expected that it would be able to stabilize nanoparticles efficiently and highly dispersed.
I mean, yeah, that was your title, bulky group. So I should have been a little more, thinking about that. So anyway, that's great. So I really enjoyed the chemistry and I'd be happy to listen to other people's questions here. So that's basically the ones that I had at least.
Thank you so much.
Now I invite Dr. Charu, Dr. Ujjwal Kumar, and Dr. Vikas Rana for the questions. You are the members of our doctoral research committee.
So I have just one question if Dr. Arun permits. Dr. Arun, if you permit, then I would like to ask one question.
You can ask as many as you want.
I have just one question. Being DRC member, I have been keeping a very close watch on how it works. So I guess I would like to ask you, Ayushi, we were discussing the other day. So if you have something else to add to the answer you have given me previously, which of these following complexes in the catalyst you have made, you think the best one? And why it is so, and how would you like to improve your best catalysis for your future research work if given a chance?
Okay. Ma'am, though I have explored all the catalysts in different chemical transformations, so it won't be an exact comparison, but I think the last study actually that is an organotellurium compound that acts as a pre-catalytic system. Let me move on. This one, this catalyst, I think this is the best catalytic system, I think, because first of all, it has allowed the reaction to occur at a very low catalyst loading. And And its high catalytic activity, I think, is just because of the small size of the nanoparticles and they are highly dispersed. And to improve it, I want to try this catalyst not only in Suzuki coupling reaction that has been already known, but in some coupling reactions, like I would like to explore it in the O-annihilation of phenol and would see if we can go beyond 0.1 mole percent of catalyst loading, or if this catalyst loading works for that particular reaction as well. So I would like to try it with different chemical transformations, the ones that have been rarely explored or that have been explored at higher concentrations. So I would like to explore this catalyst loading and optimize it for them as well.
Okay. So Ayushi, just a follow-up question on what you said. The recyclability of the catalyst you think is the best one out of your whole study, is it the best among the other work you have reported, or you are compromising on the recyclability but you have a low loading, low requirement of a catalyst for a particular reaction? So what is your point of view on that?
Ma'am, for testing the recyclability factor, we have never compromised on the catalyst loading part. I mean, we have optimized it first. Then we have tested the recyclability. So in the present study, wherever I have been, wherever I have tested the recyclability studies, I think they have been found recyclable, and I have not compromised on any factor, whatever, I mean, the percentage conversion has been obtained after each reaction cycle, I think.
Maybe I was not clear in asking my question. So to put it in a simpler words, you have four systems and they all have their own recyclability and they have their own capacity or the loading requirement, or I'll say, the amount which is required of the catalyst for a particular reaction. So if you look at these two factors simultaneously and then you grade your system, which one is the best? So still you'll say this last one is the best? I'm not finished yet. The reason I'm asking is because the size reported here is very small. So that is giving me an impression the recovery or recyclability could be a problem, though I have not worked on the system, not from the field also. So just out of curiosity, I'm asking, does this very small size poses some problem during recyclability?
Ma'am, for this particular study, which is just now on the slide, the in situ generated PD9TE4, I have not tested its recyclability. But when this phase was designed using single source precursor, the size was relatively larger. It was 10 to 25 nanometers. So in that case, I have actually tested the recyclability till 6 reaction cycles. And among the two different studies in which I have actually tested the recyclability of the nanoparticles and the heterogeneous catalytic systems, I think the heterogeneous catalytic system would be better because it is easily recyclable. It's just magnetic separation by an external magnet. So.
So in terms of recyclability, your iron system is better, and in terms of catalyst loading, this telluride based system is better. Is it what you are conveying?
Yes, yes, ma'am.
Okay. Okay, that is all from my side, Dr. Arun. Thank you.
Hello, Ayushi, am I audible?
Yes, sir.
First of all, I would like to congratulate for your work and your presentation. Wonderful presentation. And I already interact with you during your previous progresses. So for this day, I have only two or three questions. First of all, I would like to know about the how did you purify your products during the preparation, like PD94, PDT. And second, my second question is, what are your future plannings for your products, and how would you like to introduce your products in industry, at industry level, or for other purposes, and do you have any plan for that? Or third, I would like to know about the stability of nanoparticles which you produced, because I think Dr. John also inquired about it, but during this time my connection was not proper, so I was not able to listen this. So please, first I would like to know about the purification
of the bimetallic alloys, that is PD94 and PDT nanostructures.
And then your future plans for your study.
Okay. Sir, actually, there was no exact purification technique that we actually followed. When the reaction cooled down, we centrifuged it, separated the organic content, and washed it repeatedly 3 times with acetone and water. So it removed the organic content, and then we sent it, we centrifuged it, we dried it under, and then we characterized it using PXRD. So they were found to be like all the high intensity peaks matched with the required phase. So the washing during centrifugation we centrifuged and then we washed it, and then centrifuged and then washed it. We did it repeatedly for 3 to 4 times. So that was the purification part. With respect to the future plans, I think tellurides, these palladium tellurides have not been explored in other categories. Like, I would like to explore them for, like I said, to Dr. Charu, like with other chemical transformations, and see if they work well with some other transformations as well. Also, I would like to test them for their semiconductor properties. I have actually seen one or two papers in which metal sulfides and metal selenides have been used as OLED materials, the organic LED materials. So I think metal tellurides have not been explored in that category. So I wish to do some study in that particular regard as well. And with respect to industrial scale, I think this tellurium ligated PD2 catalyst, I would love to test it at in bulk scale reactions, so at gram scale reactions, so that we can actually check its feasibility for industrial scale.
And what about the stability of nanoparticles which you have prepared?
So these nanoparticles were quite stable. They had a shelf life of 6 months to 1 year, because I used them for the catalysis. I mean, I synthesized them, I kept it, and then I used them after nearly 6 to 7 months in the catalysis, checking the catalysis of these of one or two substrates. So I found relatively similar yield, similar percentage conversion, I would say. So I think they possess a long shelf life.
What are your criteria for the estimation of shelf life? Because you are using again and again shelf life, and because shelf life is very important in industrial products. What are your criteria for the shelf life estimation?
Sir, actually, there can be two parameters through which we can judge it. First is we can actually check the catalytic activity if there is any inhibition in that. I mean, earlier, like it was 80%, or now it has been reduced. And we can also go for these TEM studies to see if over the time they have been agglomerated, or there is some change in the morphology over a period of time. So with both these things, we can actually check the shelf life if they are active even after certain months or years.
If a layman wants to use a catalyst, your catalytic products, he or she have to check these properties before application, or through this and that.
Since I have already seen that there is no difference in the percentage conversion obtained, I think if somebody from my lab or from any, want to use the catalyst that I prepared, I think they can go ahead and use it, and it won't much matter. I mean, there won't be a problem with that. They can use it without performing an HRTEM. I think they can.
Okay, Ayushi, once again, I would like to congratulate you. And I hope that you will submit your thesis in very short period of time. Congratulations for your work and your presentation and your publications and your mentor also.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Vikas. Now I invite the students to interact with Ayushi and ask the questions and their queries, if any. All the students are
Good morning, Dee.
Good morning.
Dee, could you explain the palladium NMR? NMR,
I mean, you want me to explain the proton, carbon 13 or 125T? Which one?
Palladium one.
Palladium one. Just a moment.
Yes.
Okay, just a moment. So this is the actually the 125T NMR of a palladium complex. And if I slideshow it, would be from the beginning. Then actually what happens is when palladium binds with the organotellurium ligand, there is a deshielding of around the tellurium nucleus, and hence the peak, which is supposedly in one case of mine is at 460, is at 451 ppm. It gets deshielded because of the drift in the electron density away from the nucleus to 621.90 ppm. So there's a shift of about 170 ppm from the with respect to the ligand. The ligand in ligand the the signal was at 451 ppm, while when palladium binds to the tellurium and nitrogen of that particular ligand, it gets shifted, it gets deshielded towards more downside. So that happens when palladium metal binds with that, actually corroborate the successful binding of palladium with tellurium or with any other donor.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Are there any more questions?
I think there are no more questions. So I thank you all the students, DRC members for joining so early in the morning. I also thank you very much, Professor John, for being kind enough and providing me a number of slots for his availability.
Okay, thank you very much. I've enjoyed it. Very nice to hear the seminar, also to meet some new colleagues. So thanks for including me. I appreciate it.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Professor John. So now session is closed.
Thank you, everyone. And thank you, Dr. John, for joining.
Bye-bye.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you very much. I leave? Should we end it?
Yeah, you can end it.
Thank you, sir.